Major funding for America's War on Poverty was provided by the Ford Foundation, the Charles Stewart Mott Foundation, the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, and by the annual financial support of viewers like you. In addition, America's War on Poverty was also supported by the generous donations of foundations and individuals. A complete list of funders is available from PBS.
From the fields of California to the hollows of Appalachia, those fighting America's war on poverty were testing controversial new strategies.
I think they were ready for us to provide a little additional food assistance and a little welfare benefits, but not to attack the governmental structure.
For every ounce of federal help we get, we surrender an ounce of personal freedom. The great society grows greater every day, greater in cost, greater in inefficiency, and greater in waste.
I know what poverty means to people. We are going to build a great society.
Every man and woman has a chance for fulfillment and prosperity and hope. This can be done.
Young people across America, awakened by a decade of social change, responded to a call to action from the Office of Economic Opportunity. Some gave up high-paying legal or medical jobs. Others postponed college in order to fight America's war on poverty.
The war on poverty embodied an exciting concept, and that was to bring the middle class and the poor together in a partnership to work with the poor, not to do things to them or to do things for them, but to work with them.
Nearly everybody in their life needs someone to help them. I don't care whether you're the greatest self-made man in the history of self-made men or women. The fact is somebody has helped you along the way. And FISTA volunteers were supposed to try to provide a part of the help.
VISTA, Volunteers in Service to America, trained recruits briefly and then sent them into the nation's poorest neighborhoods and rural outposts.
I had not been on an overnight train, and waking up in the morning when daylight came, seeing a whole countryside that looked totally different, you know, the real red earth of the Virginia clay soil, and all the honeysuckle in bloom at the time. And I remember standing in between the train cars and actually smelling that wonderful honeysuckle smell.
Ever-deepening poverty in the coal mining regions of Kentucky, Virginia, and West Virginia, the heart of Appalachia, drew more than 700 VISTAs in the summer of 1966. Most joined a regional organization called the Appalachian Volunteers.
I remember John Kennedy's words, "Ask not what your country can do for you, but what you can do for your country." That was very present in my mind, and very present in the minds of all the AVs.
The Appalachian Volunteers also recruited from within local communities.
Up until then, I'd always thought I wanted to leave the mountains. The idea was to just, you know, get to college, get an education, go to Ohio and get a job teaching and be out of it. But I really was looking for something different, and I was thinking, and this touched something that was emotional in me that I could give to.
The Volunteers arrived at a time of record unemployment. In a region dependent on coal mining, automation had put thousands of people out of work.
The had no jobs, they had no roads, they had no hospitals. Their educational system was very weak and substandard. Their young people had all kinds of health problems. And we had no ability to attract jobs to the area.
People live very hard, very common for beds, and two or three beds, even in the living room. That was the living room furniture, because there were so many children and not enough space. Even smaller families with two or three children, they had beds every place.
Hoping the Vistas might be able to help, some families welcomed them.
I just volunteered this summer of putting them, placing them in homes. And I had two, maybe four, in my home. Like John, for instance, he cut his pant legs off, and he cut one high and one low. And he'd go barefooted, and he would work with the boys. But he felt like, well, these kids don't have much, and so I'm not going to have much. But the people thought that he was making fun of them.
As the Vistas settled in, they searched for ways to involve local residents in projects.
The schoolhouses were in deplorable condition. I started remembering how bad the schoolhouse was that I went to. It was very oppressive for me. I remember being in a one-room school and sitting there all day with nothing to do. And I remember thinking if there was some way I could do to make that better.
We believe that in giving, we are the ones to receive.
The call went out across the country to get people to donate books, certain kinds of books, geography books and reference books. And I remember encyclopedias, there were thousands of World Book encyclopedias, it seems like.
We set our hands to the plow to build a better America in the here.
There were a lot of books there I had not read yet, and there were children's books, so I'd sit down and read them before I'd take them on, things like that. And so I read all my children's books late in life, but it was exciting.
You like got three of me.
Yeah.
Once you got to know the children, they'd all take you home to their houses, and then you'd meet their parents, and you'd meet the older kids, and you immediately got to know everybody in the community by knowing the younger kids. And one family was the Atkins family. They were a family whose father worked in the mines and worked very hard. They had a number of children that lived in one of the coal camp houses, but they didn't have running water. And I remember how hard the mother worked in keeping the kids clean. And the prices of the food in the company-owned store were twice as high. And so, of course, she never had any extra money, and they never got ahead. And this really came, this was the one, you know, one of the families that really came up against what, you know, I was taught as a child, that if you work very hard in this country, you can get ahead. And here was a family that had worked very hard all of their lives, and they had nothing. And it was through really no fault of their own, but the way the system was set up.
In the mining towns of Kentucky, coal companies often owned the stores and dominated local governments. Their property taxes were low, and most companies paid no tax on the value of the coal they extracted.
We started becoming really aware that the profits from this coal was going to land companies and coal companies that were owned by interest. Totally outside the region. And those people, by the way, did not do any philanthropy in the area.
I think this area should be very happy that corporations such as ours, U.S. Steel and others, are here. They're good companies. They're honorable companies.
As far as this story about sucking the riches and leaving nothing, I would have to dispute that, because let's take the town of Jenkins. Jenkins was developed by Consolidation Coal Company in the early part of the century. And Jenkins had the schools built, the hospitals, the stores, the houses. Over 1,000 homes were built by the coal company to bring labor in, because they needed labor to operate the mines.
Times had changed. Automation reduced the need for workers. It also threatened the land itself. Huge strip mining machines took coal from above ground quickly and cheaply. But the widespread excavation caused soil erosion, water pollution, and severe mudslides.
It was destroying people's homes. For a lot of folks, this is all they had left. All they had was their gardens and their houses. And if you've ever seen strip mining, seen it up close or seen it from an airplane, it destroys everything in its path.
Here is the result. It has pushed us out, and now the land, timber, and everything else is gone, home and all. My family owns the land and the home, but we have not got nothing for it yet.
It was an eye-opener for people who perhaps were somewhat naive about the way society functions. The allocation of resources was in the hands of a very small group of politicians. Need was not a criteria that drove their decisions. Political support was what governed their decisions.
The people who wanted to stay that were able to gain the political power and keep control were able to take care of the folks they wanted to, help them stay in power. But there were many left out.
Vistas and those who worked with them began to face reprisals.
I was a cook at the school, and I had cooked 2 years. So when it come time to be hard to go back to school, I wasn't. They didn't say why, and they wouldn't give any answer. So I wasn't hard to go back to school.
Political people don't like to have volunteers working in their among their constituents, you might say, finding out how bad things are, and particularly in your congressional district, let's say, for some of the people in your district. You don't want that exposed. You don't care about Peace Corps volunteers exposing the same conditions in Brazil or Tanzania. That's far enough away, and it doesn't affect you politically. But when a Vista volunteer goes in and starts pointing out defects, social defects, economic defects in your congressional district, that does affect you, and you don't like it.
Volunteers from within Appalachia were struck by the way volunteers from the outside reacted to setbacks.
I really became real aware of a middle class sense of having a right to. I mean, it was amazing to me that they were amazed at how local politicians would be little demagogues and would put stumbling blocks, because the things that they were trying to help communities get seemed made good sense to them. It was a middle class, any good middle class community would have moved towards improving the road or improving the school system or any of the kind of things that we were trying to do.
Hoping to raise awareness of the problems in Appalachia, the Vistas brought nearly 200 residents to the nation's capital in August 1966. People who had never left their home counties met face to face with their elected officials. That night, camping out in a Washington school, it was the Vistas who faced criticism.
We had like a big supper and cooking and everything, and then people got up and sort of talked about, they testified is what they did.
People then really truly lined out the things that we should do, that we needed to do more than just, fix up a bridge or whatever, that the power structure, had a kind of a death grip on many communities, that strip mining was destroying the whole economy and destroying the lands.
We were taking the message pretty serious. I was. Other AVs were. Go out there and eradicate poverty. Well, that's more than just putting books in a library.
Vistas now join the local battle against strip mining.
We have a guest at our meeting tonight. Tracy Hilton is our representative in the state Senate. And
in Kentucky, that opposition focused on a century-old contract known as the Broad Form Deed. The deed was used by coal operators to buy the rights to minerals under people's land. In an age of strip mining, it was still upheld by the courts.
We would feel as though if we had the mineral rights, that this is ours to mine, and the deed for this coal gives us the right to mine the coal by any method that we want to use, whether, and it doesn't say surface mining or deep mining, it just says any known method.
It was like the final straw. It was like the most dramatic black and white contrast of who's in charge and who isn't.
Well, what I think we should do is the whole community get together and figure out what the room is. Take care of themselves.
There was a community, a local community, just over the mountain from where Joe and I lived, and a place called Island Creek. And there's an elderly gentleman there by the name of Jink Ray, and his wife, whose name was Cricket, who had a very small farm. This is all that they had in the world. And a strip mine company from an independent coal operator was coming round the mountain to their land.
On July 17th, 1967, the bulldozer arrived. Supported by the Malloys and other protesters, two of Jink Ray's neighbors blocked its way.
One of them had a rock. One of the guys was trying to throw it. And then one of the other fellows sort of scrambled up the bank a little bit and sort of waved at the bulldozer operator like, you know, we're here.
The bulldozer operator stopped then. And then from what we understood is he got down and just said, I'm not going to do this.
A neighbor telegraphed Governor Breathitt. The governor flew to Jink Ray's farm.
I put in there, built there 1926, and I worked hard, common labor, and built up a little state place. And it's pretty hard, Governor, for somebody to come in and just tell you to move out and give it up to them.
I know. You're right, and that's why I'm on your side. I would hope that we are able to find a method to whereby we can hold an industry but still protect the land on these steep slopes. Now, that's our objective. And I promise you that I'll be
in an unprecedented move, the governor revoked the strip miner's permit.
Ooh, it was good. You felt like you won something. You felt like the peoples had power, and the numbers of peoples had power, and that it really did something. It helped. It helped the people. It helped. It just gave you a thrill to think, you know, there's power in the people.
Three weeks later, the Malloys learned that two of their co-workers had been arrested and charged with sedition.
We're standing in our kitchen. My wife's got her nightgown on and I've got, you know, shorts or something, and we're talking and trying to figure out what sedition is.
About maybe three or four cars came up our road, and we lived up a little holler in a little farmhouse. And they surrounded the house, and about 15 armed sheriffs or whatever came to the door.
This person bounded up the steps ahead of everybody else and demanded I open up, so they were the police, and they were here to arrest me.
District Attorney Tom Ratliff, a strip mine operator, charged Joe Malloy with advocating the violent overthrow of the state of Kentucky.
I was scared for them. I was afraid that they would be hurt in the jail. So we were really scared about their safety. And so we went to make a big noise and a big sense of presence so that the deputies and so forth would know that people knew that they were there.
The Malloys were involved in an extremely controversial issue. This wasn't a question of, you know, whether to provide services for a particular schoolhouse or whether to improve a road or how to allocate resources in a minimal way. I mean, this challenged sort of fundamental economic decisions that people were making about how they wanted to make money.
We certainly, I hope, don't have to put up with people coming here financed by tax money trying to promote Marxism or communism or any kind of subversive activities in eastern Kentucky. I know I don't want to put up with it.
I'm born and raised here 62 years in these mountains. We've always made a living without OEO and without vistas. These people don't even take a bath. I've got up and left the restaurant on occasion or two when these filthy things Come in. The odor is so bad you can't eat your breakfast. Jesus Christ. And the government, and the government paying these people to come in here and tell us how to live.
They were all hammering me, the judges and the school superintendents particularly, that these people were not accomplishing anything now, that all they were doing was creating trouble.
We would hear people talk about, how we were going to organize the Red Guards in Pike County, and that we were going to bring in black people from Detroit to riot.
The people wouldn't come to meetings. People wouldn't let their children come out. They didn't understand. They didn't know what communists were, and they didn't know what the word communist meant.
That's a great way to stop a movement, is to put that kind of fear of the unknown and witch hunt kind of atmosphere into people's lives so that they stop talking to you, they stop talking to each other. You know, nothing went forward.
In Eastern Kentucky in particular, the program was in some of its elements curtailed. But I think even more dramatic was the way in which the controversy was used in the late 60s and the early 70s by conservative politicians to rein in the entire war on poverty.
In the years since the Vistas arrived in Appalachia, opposition to the war on poverty had been gaining momentum.
The people are fully justified in demanding an explanation of this disastrous program and how it is now proposed to spend still more of their hard-earned money and rapidly vanishing income in this wasteful and reckless way.
In September 1967, a month after Joe Malloy's arrest, Governor Breathitt completed a report on rural poverty nationwide. Calling the problem desperate, he urged the Johnson administration to provide something it had previously ruled out, a federally funded jobs program. The governor submitted his report to the president's assistant, Harry McPherson.
Harry says we can't do it. He says the poverty program itself is under fire in the Congress. We're trying now to get funding to continue the poverty program. The costs of our efforts in Vietnam, the costs of our other domestic programs are such that to add a big new program has met such resistance within the Congress that we're not going to be able to officially release this report and embrace it.
6 days later, a federal court cleared Joe Malloy of all charges.
I think they figured that by arresting me for sedition and branding me as a communist, that they would get the AV money cut off from Washington. And that just isn't happening.
The day after the sedition charge was thrown out, my draft board reclassified me as 1A and issued a draft induction notice. Literally the day after. The day it appeared in the newspapers that we were set free.
Volunteers would continue to work in Appalachia, repairing schoolhouses, tutoring children, and establishing craft cooperatives. Their partnership with local organizations led to new laws regulating strip mining in West Virginia and Kentucky.
Part of my job was to go around and talk to people. And then I would say, talk to me about the volunteers. They wouldn't be there. Just tell me what you think. What's happening here? And the emotion that would pour out, it nothing quite like that had ever happened before. And it wasn't the services. It wasn't the extra books for the schoolhouse. It was the sense that their lives could change.
In Appalachia, Vistas saw the law used against the poor. In Washington, designers of the war on poverty believed the law could also be used to help them. In 1966, the Office of Economic Opportunity unveiled its newest anti-poverty strategy, legal services.
Equal justice under law is across the top of the Supreme Court building in the United States of America. And until we get equal justice under the law for everybody, we're not fulfilling the Constitution of our country or the ideals.
Legal services would face a critical test in the agricultural valleys of rural California. California produced more of the nation's fruit and vegetables than any other state in the country. The men and women who worked the fields belonged to many ethnic groups. The largest number were American citizens of Mexican descent. They earned as little as 75 cents an hour, and because their work was seasonal, faced long periods of unemployment. Children often contributed to family income.
When I was in junior high, I went up to the field foreman and asked him when the grape picking season would be over. And he asked, gee, why are you asking? I told him, well, we always get back to school late and we have to work doubly hard catch up. He looked at me and says, why, you're the first Mexican kid I ever talked to who was interested in education. I remember being furious inside. And I told myself, you know, someday I'm going to go back and look up that field foreman, and I'm going to have my college diploma in my left hand. I'm going to poke him in the nose with my right.
Farm workers moved throughout the agricultural season, living in housing provided by growers.
This town is way off the freeway, so you never see it. Thousands and thousands of people are living like this, and they're farm workers. You actually begin to develop your own sense of values, you know. Some shacks are better than other shacks, you know, but they're all shacks. And then after summer's gone, they're asked to leave these camps and to move on. The whole system kind of encourages migrant life of the farm worker.
I came as a migrant farm worker, and we came to this housing here in Soledad, and it was a labor camp. And it was a farm labor camp, which was previously a prisoner of war camp for the Second World War. They used to house Germans here in Soledad, and they converted into farm labor housing. The conditions were terrible, and I thought that was degrading, and I thought that has to be changed. And I didn't know how at first, how to make those changes.
In the spring of 1966, Jim Lorenz, a 28-year-old Harvard Law School graduate, asked OEO for money to establish California Rural Legal Assistance, CRLA.
My vision to begin with was that we were going to be like a very, very good corporate law firm that was going to provide legal services, quality legal services for farm workers and poor people. We were going to represent groups as well as individuals. The old-fashioned legal aid programs only represented legal individuals because they didn't want to make any waves. We were going to make waves. We were going to have an impact on the legal system of California, and we're going to have an impact on these communities.
The founders of CRLA believed that what we were going to try and do was to provide the same quality of representation to poor people that middle class or better received.
Lorenz had an extraordinary ability to recruit. His recruitment of myself is an example. He recruited me, and I said yes to being the director of litigation of nothing. At the time I said yes, he had received no funds, no commitment of funds, and there were none of the 10 offices that he had promised had yet been set up.
Para mantenernos. ¿Qué pasa con ustedes?
No es una mentira eso que nosotros les andamos diciendo.
Organizer Cesar Chavez was also recruited to advise CRLA.
Oiga, compañero.
Chavez was leading a nationwide grape boycott and a strike against California's growers in an effort to build a farm workers' union. Agricultural workers, unlike their counterparts in industry, did not have a federally protected right to form unions.
It is very interesting. The argument has always been that we were excluded because agriculture is somehow different. The high peaks of employment, the perishability of the crops and so forth. But if we really examine it, you know, we're very sure that we were excluded primarily because the majority of the farm worker in America is a minority group.
Cesar Chavez, it was like he'd lit a grass fire all across rural California. It was electrifying. Here was a charismatic leader, and the prospect of his organizing farm workers in a way that they'd never been organized before was scaring a lot of people in agribusiness.
During the mid and late 60s, the power of agriculture was quite extraordinary. It was the number one business in California. It influenced what banks would say and do. It influenced what politicians would say and do. And it influenced what most newspapers would say and do.
Do you plan to continue boycott activities against some growers?
Well, we plan to continue to do those things that are going to bring economic pressure against the growers. You see, since we don't have any protection under the federal law to resolve these conflicts as industrial workers have, then we're put in a position that we have to use all of the legal means at our disposal to bring economic pressure on the growers to get them to even to agree to an election. And so we'll be continuing doing boycotting, striking, and other things that are necessary to bring this about.
By the end of the summer, the great boycott had cost growers thousands of dollars. When the growers' attorneys learned that CRLA planned to work on behalf of the Farm Workers Union, they complained to OEO.
This shows you how green and naive I was. I expected them to give me an award, that I was going to do all these wonderful things for farm workers. And instead, they sent a telegram to Sergeant Schreiber. It had two lines. It said, "We unanimously oppose this program because it is seeking to take sides in a struggle still pending." The "still pending" was really nice. I mean, that was really that lawyer touch, right? And Shriver's reaction was, he phoned John Sutro, who was then the president of State Bar. He said, "Look, John," he said, "if your firm, Pillsbury, Madison, and Sutro, stops representing growers," he says, "I'll be happy not to fund this."
California Rural Legal Assistance was funded with one restriction. It could not represent any labor union. The lawyers opened 10 offices statewide.
I found that when I went to Salinas, and this was typical of virtually all of the lawyers, that we were white, male, and middle class. And myself, I came with special handicaps. I was from Brooklyn. I didn't speak Spanish. I had never been in a rural area. I had never worked with farm workers. And I realized I was going to be a total failure, except in a technical sense, unless I enriched the office with community workers.
I was working at a garage, local garage in Soledad. And one of the fellas told me, "Somebody out there looking for you." And I said, "Okay." So I got out from underneath the car, went over there, and I saw these two Anglos, you know, well-dressed in the pinstripe suits. And I said, first thought was, "Wow, what did I do wrong now? You know, the FBI must be after me for something." And I said, I'm not guilty. And then they said, "Well, we're lawyers from CRLA. And so I would like for you to come work with us."
With the help of community workers, CRLA lawyers looked for cases that would address farm worker issues. Among these was the use of braceros, low-paid seasonal workers that the federal government brought in from Mexico. The use of braceros was supported by California's leading politicians and businessmen.
Every person who was unemployed in California not only had an opportunity to replace the braceros, they were begged, they were solicited. Free transportation was provided to get them to the fields. It was just too easy to go back on the welfare rolls, and I'm not just picking on the Negro, Negro and white.
Are you saying that you can't get American workers?
No, we can't get no American workers.
What?
Yeah.
What do you
tomorrow morning, tonight. Yeah, bring them down.
What do you say to their argument that if you raise the wages and made working conditions
Well, you go
better.
To the academy and tell us to pay more money for them, for the thing, and then you guys will squawk that you have to pay too damn much, the housewife has to pay too much for the stuff on the counter.
The Department of Labor began importing braceros during World War II to fill a labor shortage. 20 years later, growers continue to benefit from the availability of low-paid foreign workers.
These braceros gave the wage structure a kind of a bottomless character for the local workers. The local workers could not support a family, take care of United States expenses on the wages that braceros were paid and happily took.
The local farm workers would never be able to do better economically so long as their competitors were the low-paid braceros. So it was to the interest of the local farm workers not to have the bracero program.
By law, California growers could not hire braceros without first offering the jobs to American workers and guaranteeing them clean water, toilets in the fields, and the prevailing wage. CRLA set out to prove that these conditions were not being met.
One of the ways we tried to help the attorneys was to try to take pictures of the existing situations, the lack of clean drinking water, the lack of toilets, the lack of safeguarding for children. And since it was a very novel thing to have a camera in a farm work field, caused a lot of, you know, vigilance on the part of the labor contractor, the local people who knew that we were up to something strange.
We went into the tomato fields and we looked at the wreckage, and we noticed that one person by the name of Gonzalez had earned over $120 the day before, and that he had picked enough tomatoes, over 50,000, to feed every person in Salinas. We went to interview Mr. Gonzalez, and Mr. Gonzalez said he was not just Gonzalez, it was 14 Gonzalez's working, and that they had not worked the 8 hours the grower had claimed, but had worked 14 hours each. And so instead of earning $120 for the day's work, each Gonzalez had earned under $10 a day and less than a dollar an hour.
CRLA brought the evidence to the U.S. Department of Labor. Negotiations led to an agreement that ended the bracero program after the 1967 harvest. It was a significant victory for the farm workers.
There was a change when the CRLA came to town. What kind of a change?
Well, first, the big change was the attitude about the lawyer toward the client, and they make us feel like we were the president of Ford Motor Company.
The war on poverty clearly was designed to be a confrontation between the so-called folks left out of capitalism and those who were profiting by the capitalist system. That was how it was framed by the people who ran it. And that tells you about their philosophy. And if
people don't run... CRLA now filed suit against California's governor, Ronald Reagan. Reagan had made selective cuts in state-subsidized medical services for the poor. He eliminated most surgeries and dental care and ended distribution of eyeglasses and hearing aids.
Certainly, we're all agreed that no one in this country should be denied medical care because of a lack of funds. But at the same time, it just doesn't make sense that those who earn and pay their own way must provide medical care without stint at a level of quality and quantity for others who are not working, above which they can afford for themselves and their own families.
Spent 12 days in traction, supposed to have had surgery. When Governor Reagan made his cuts, when my surgery was canceled, I couldn't get any back brace or a belt. So I contacted CRLA.
We saw what was happening when we got a call from a client of ours in the Modesto office who had been scheduled for surgery, for back surgery. Then he got a call from the doctor saying, we can't render the surgery, though you need it, because we have new state regulations that prescribe that type of surgery. We checked into it and found that the doctor was right. There were those regulations, but when checking those state statutes and regulations, we saw that they were unlawful.
The cuts violated state law because they targeted specific services. CRLA's suit forced the governor to restore more than $810 million worth of medical care to California's poor.
That's when the movement started in the Reagan administration to totally eliminate our program.
We think that it's gone a little afield in which it's kind of become a promoter of social causes.
There was a clear socialist agenda that was emanating from OEO in Washington and that was found around the country and in California. So if they wanted to do that, fine, but on their own nickel, not asking the taxpayers to finance it.
Governor Reagan has said CRLA shouldn't get involved in social causes. Are you doing that?
Yes, sir. We're involved with poor people. And whether we like it or not, or they like it or not, they are a social cause. In fact, there are a whole series of social causes who are poor people.
Governor Reagan probably will veto the program when it comes up for refunding in a few weeks. And in Washington, there have been ominous rumblings among members of California's congressional delegation. CRLA's demise would be a deep disappointment to California's rural poor, who would find it hard to break the new habit of saying, see my lawyers.
When lawyers were opposing our efforts to help the poor through legal processes, it really riled me. And when people who were elected, like a governor or a senator, tried to stop that, I felt that they were attacking one of the fundamental foundations of this republic.
Shriver vowed to protect CRLA's funding. But the OEO director was facing his own battles. In the fall of 1967, Congress threatened to reduce the War on Poverty budget.
If the Congress is unwilling to appropriate enough money to run a substantial attack against poverty, then nobody would want to be the head of an agency that was guilty of a fraud, really, on the American people.
I believe there was a narrow period of opportunity to make change. I didn't believe that the Lyndon Johnson commitment would last, even if Lyndon Johnson was reelected, because I could see among the Democratic leadership an annoyance that CRLA was seeking actually to empower the farm workers and empower the poor.
Shriver's budget was finally approved. A few months later, Johnson withdrew from the 1968 presidential election. He offered Shriver a post as ambassador to France.
I came to the conclusion, honestly, that I had done what I could do, circumstances being what they were politically and financially right at that moment in the country, to help poor people.
I hereby am proudly move on behalf of my fellow Californians that this convention declare itself as unanimously and united behind the candidate Richard Nixon as the next president of the United States, and I so move.
With Reagan's support, Richard Nixon was elected president in 1968. In California, the farm workers' strike against grape growers was in its third year. CRLA turned its attention to the education of farm workers' children.
This lady, Mrs. Melchor, comes to the office with this little girl, Maria, and says, my girl doesn't want to go to school anymore.
Maria no quería ir a la escuela.
Maria didn't want to go to school, but she wouldn't say why. Then I asked her, but why? And she said, because they didn't put me in a good room. That's what she said. And I didn't know what she meant by that.
We spoke to the superintendent about the concerns that we had, that Mrs. Melchor had. And so he took us to this room, and this room was full of brown faces, you know, Hispanic children, and a few Anglo. And I said, well, what are they doing here? And he says, well, the problem is that they don't understand English. So the teacher, in order to remove them from the classroom, called the psychiatrist, and the psychiatrist came, did some tests on them, and the psychiatrist concluded that they were slow mentally. We asked the superintendent whether the tests were conducted in English or in Spanish. And the superintendent said in English, because apparently the psychiatrist didn't speak Spanish.
We had them tested by a bilingual psychologist and found that not one of them was in fact of the category in terms of IQ that should be in an educationally mentally retarded class. Possible exception of one. The daughter of the lady who came to see us had an IQ of something like 145.
No nomás María.
It wasn't only María. It was a lot of kids. And we began to realize that the school was getting paid for those kids that they treated like that. It was then that we became outraged, because we realized that the school was making money off our daughter. And so we started to fight to take Maria out of there.
When we filed suit, it was not just against that school district. We had since investigated and found that classes like that were found throughout the state.
In February 1970, the California Board of Education retested the students in their primary language. As a result, over 22,000 Spanish-speaking American children were removed from classes for the mentally retarded. That summer, the Farm Workers Union won recognition from California grape growers, ending the 5-year boycott. But anti-union activity by lettuce growers led to a new strike, and CRLA was drawn into the conflict.
I think that was the closest that we came to what was, not, of course, we can't say a joint operation because we were precluded from representing the Farm Workers Union, but there was nothing to stop us from representing members.
I think it's going to take a week or two, but I think most of our employees are going to realize that they have a good thing with us and we've treated them right. In fact, a lot of these boys on the picket lines today have free housing from us, and a lot of them we've identified. We even gave a $50 advance to last Friday because they were short of money. So it's a little ironic today to see them out here picketing our operation.
All of the striking workers lived in housing provided by the employer. The first response to the strike was to attempt to evict all the farm workers. So it became a massive landlord-tenant defense from our point of view, lawsuit from their point of view. And clearly with migrant farm workers, if they're evicted, not only do they lose housing for themselves and their children and schooling and everything else, but that is one way, effectively, to break the back of a strike immediately.
We received complaints up and down the state, primarily from the agricultural areas where CRLA was located, that they were filing all kinds of class actions, were representing the Farm Workers Union. They were hurting the farm communities with their activities.
The governor asked Lewis Euler to investigate.
When we first heard rumors that CRLA was being investigated, I called Lou and said, Lou, if you have any concerns at all, we want to hear about it and we want to correct them. He said, oh, Cruz, I'll let you know. He never called. The next thing we knew, we had been vetoed.
The law prescribes that a governor shall have the right of veto when, on the basis of evidence, he being closer to the scene than the federal government, he determines that the program is not beneficial to the people, is not fulfilling its original purpose.
These diversions from its major mission include, but are certainly not limited to, the representation of people charged with crimes, solicitation of clients, counseling and organizing students to challenge school authority, discipline systems, and the undue fixation of energies on cases with extraordinary publicity value.
We got the charges put together by Lou Euler and his investigators, and they included absolutely outrageous charges, charging us with serious felonies. They said that we had, for example, cut up affidavits and filed false affidavits in cases. That's a felony. That we had fomented murder in prisons, that we had done all these terrible things.
CRLA appealed to the Office of Economic Opportunity.
Let me say we are confident that when all the facts are in to OEO in Washington, and we have already given them this book, which is a full and complete rebuttal of the first 12 charges that the governor's office made initially 2 weeks ago, that OEO will override this veto on the merits.
Reagan's veto caused problems for the Nixon administration.
It was very much in our interest to see Reagan succeed in California. His support was important to us politically, but it was also functionally very important to us. So the argument was that we had a direct interest in what was happening there.
Supporters of legal services nationwide pressured OEO to override the veto. To settle the conflict, Nixon aides commissioned a panel of three judges to review Reagan's charges.
It was almost embarrassing to be a lawyer at some of those hearings and to see what evidence they had in support of these charges. I mean, they'd relied on, as we'd like to say in the law, the rankest hearsay, the most vitriolic, unsupported garbage.
As the judges heard the testimony, they became convinced that there was no basis for those charges, and they started issuing, rather unusual for judges, press releases saying, we don't find any basis for charges A, B, and C. Eventually, they wrote a report that was overwhelmingly favorable to CRLA.
The Reagan people and the CRLA people had both agreed to abide by the recommendations of this commission, so that took us off the hook.
California Rural Legal Assistance still works on behalf of the poor. Since 1971, CRLA has set legal precedents in the areas of consumer fraud, pesticide use, and workers' rights. The farm workers continue to organize for better working conditions and for recognition of their union.
Oh, that's the problem right there. You guarantee me that I'll sell a box of grapes and so I can make a profit and pay you $2 an hour. We make a deal, $3 an hour, $5 an hour. I don't care, whatever you want, but you guarantee me enough when I sell a box of grapes that I can pay you that much.
CRLA believed, and we all believed, that it was in no one's interest to have an underfed, undereducated, under everything population, that those problems will not be solved without the humanizing of the worker population and the improvement in living standards, education, and everything else.
There is only one way to eradicate poverty, and that is to have a free society in which the people who produce wealth are able to reinvest that wealth to create more jobs and more wealth. Now, we know that from looking at the world. Communism has failed, socialism has failed, wherever. We can't do it by government programs. War on poverty has failed. We've got to return to the nature of this nation, which is freedom. That's what works.
There are many critics now of the war on poverty. I lived through it, and I'm not a critic, and I'm not cynical about it at all. I think it was a worthy effort. I think it empowered hundreds of thousands of people and produced some lasting results, but it did not totally reform our society. But remember, the Civil War didn't do that, nor did a number of constitutional amendments protecting the rights of both blacks and women to vote do so. So I think it's part of a larger ongoing struggle. And I think what we should learn from the 60s is we should do it again and do it more frequently. Thank you.
this series was produced by Blackside Incorporated, which is solely responsible for its content. Major funding for America's War on Poverty was provided by the Ford Foundation, the Charles Stewart Mott Foundation, the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, and by the annual financial support of viewers like you. In addition, America's War on Poverty was also supported by the generous donations of foundations and individuals. A complete list of funders is available from PBS. Video cassettes of this program for educational or institutional use may be purchased by writing or calling PBS Video. This program is not available for home video sales through this offer.
This is PBS.